The second part of the session is entitled with Security Analysis of Prints. So this is the second paper on prints. The authors are Jeremy Zhong, Ivica Nikolic, Thomas Borin, Lei Wang, and Shuang Wu. Shuang will give us the talk. Let's welcome.
Okay, thanks for the introduction. So we have another paper on prints, and the title is Security Analysis of Prints. This is a joint work with Jeremy J, Visa, Nicolin, Thomas Berman, and Lei Wang. Okay, since this cipher is introduced before, just go through these pages briefly. Prints is a lightweight block cipher published at Asia Grid last year. Yeah. You know, this construction is followed by the FS construction. And the post-whitening key is calculated from the pre-whitening key with a linear transformation. Inside the internal block cipher prints code, there's no key schedule, and the value of Q1 is XORed directly to the state together with the round constant for each round. And there are 12 rounds inside, but it follows a symmetric construction, which means the round function for the last six rounds is the inversion of the first six rounds. But the only difference is in the round constants. The round constants are related in such a way. So, for example, the constant in the first round, XOR the constant in the last one is a determined value alpha. The value of alpha is like this. And this construction is a symmetric structure result in the interesting property of the, which is called as the alpha reflection property, which means the decryption oracle is equivalent to some related key oracle, encryption oracle. You just wrap the writing keys and XOR the constant K1. Then we have the inversion of this block cipher. The claim security bound for prints is only for the single key attack. The complexity bound is to the 137 lines, where 2n is the number of data we have. In the original paper, there's no bound claimed for the related key attacks. Only a triple related key distinguisher is given. And we are very interested in how far can we go with the ability to query to the related key oracle. So, the first result I can introduce is a related key attack on four prints. Here we choose the related key like this. Just the key zero are the same. We just XOR the constant alpha to K1. Then we have a very interesting property here. Let PC and P prime C prime be the plaintext subtext pairs for key and key prime. Then we can have this conclusion. If C XOR P prime equals this value, K0 XOR LK0, then we can confirm that the value of C prime XOR P is the same value. The proof is simple. This equation, from this equation, we can know the value of Y and X prime is the same. Then, from the alpha reflection property, we know decryption in this direction is equivalent in encryption of this direction. So we know the value of X and Y prime is also the same. So we can have the result in this equation. Okay, with this property, we can have a related key attack on prints like this. First, we just query a lot of random messages, random plain text or cipher text to this oracle. And we store all the actual sum of the plain text and subtext. And for the related key oracle, we did the same thing and store the actual sum of the plain text and subtext. And then, once we have enough candidates, we expect the calculation between the value of x and y. And each calculation on them suggests that this value, d, equals c I x or p j prime, is a possible candidate for p0 xor lp0. Then how do we determine if this value is correct? We can do it like this. We just choose a random plain text and get the corresponding subtext. Then we calculate p prime. We calculate p prime as c x or d. Then we get the corresponding c prime using the related key encryption record. Then we check if p x or c prime equals the same thing. If this equation holds, we can know that this is a correct value. Then we can calculate the zero from this, since this is a bijection. So the complexity for equal attack is calculated like this. First, we need to guess the value of Q1. Then we can do this in the middle procedure. So the total complexity will be 2 to the 96. Our second result is a single cohort and principle with a chosen alpha. But before I introduce the single key attack, I want to introduce the related key formula attack and principle. First, we need to know that for the Xbox, those key prints, the best input output difference holds this probability of 2 to the minus 2. So we can choose this difference pair here. Then we have a one round differential pass with very high probability. And because there's no key schedule in principle, once we set the key difference here, and this one round differential pass can be iterated again and again. So we can construct the boomerang distribution like this. The upper six one, we choose one iterative differential pass. And for the bottom one, we choose another. And in the middle, since it's an interval, we can skip there. Okay, then the probability for one iterative pass is 2 to the minus 12. Then for the boomerang distinguisher, the calculated probability should be 2 to the minus 48. But according to our experiments, actually we can find a boomerang cortex with 2 to the 36 complexity. That's because of the amplified effects. Then we can recover the key from what we found, which is a boomerang cortex. But each time we only recover the position of the key nibbles at the active position of the difference. So we can play a little trick here. We can choose distinct difference positions in delta 1 and delta 2. So we will only need 8 boomerang cortex to recover all the 16 key nibbles in Q1. So the complexity will be like this. Then we want to convert this related key boomerang attack into a single key attack in principle. Recall the alpha reflection property for principle, its form is even simpler. We just XOR the alpha to K1. Then we have the decryption also. Then, because in a single key attack, we have only access to the oracles with the same key. But now we know the decryption oracle is equivalent to the related key encryption oracle. Then we can apply the boomerang attack like this. Every time we need to access to the encryption oracle related according to key, we just call this encryption. Once we need the related key encryption record, we just call the decryption record as long as the key difference is alpha. So if we can choose the value of alpha, we can convert this related key boomerang attack into a single key attack. But for this attack, we have a few remarks. First of all, the key difference have to be the same in the top and bottom class, because it's the same value alpha. And with this constraint, the amplified probability for the pulmonary cortex comes 2^-40. And also, we can't choose the position of the active nipples, since it's determined by the constant. And then, thus, we can recover only one nipple of the peak. But we will only need two pulmonary cortex to recover this nipple. With this kind of attack, can apply for about 240 possible values for alpha. In the last talk, the authors introduced the class of weak constants. And here we introduce another class of weak alphas. But it's worth mentioning that the alpha chosen by the designer is not in these weak values. Okay, the third result is another single key attack on four prints with a slightly lower bound. With this attack, we just exploit the possibility with the two linear relations that hold with probability one. First relation is coming from the FS construction. You know, the difference in K0 and difference in the plaintext can be cancelled by each other. Then it will result in a difference of L or delta in the ciphertext. This property holds with probability 1. And for the other linear relation, it has come from the alpha reflection property. And it's written like this. So with these two equations that holds with probability 1, what can we do is very interesting. That we can use only one offline computation to test four keys at the same time. Here, suppose this is a known context, such as text pair, then we can just randomly choose a value of K0 or K1, and we calculate offline to get the value of C prime. If C prime does not equal to C, we know, and we set this difference together, then we will have another three equations which holds with probability 1. From the first equation, we know that this key decrypt C into a value of P, X, or some non-zero value. So we know this key decrypt our ciphertext into a wrong plaintext. So this key must be wrong. And for the other two equations, if this value does not equal to P, and this value does not equal to C, we know these two keys are also not correct. So what we're doing here is just one offline computation to test four keys at the same time. But since some of the keys are not controlled by us, so sometimes we will hit the keys that were already tested before. On average, the complexity is like this. With 2 to the n queries or 2 to the n data, the complexity for this attack is 2 to the 126.47 microseconds, which is slightly lower than the claimed bound. And this complexity looks like a backplate attack, but our attack is different from the backplate attack because in the backplate attack, the number of tested keys is not reduced, and only the computation is reduced. But here in our attack, you can actually reduce the number of keys tested. That's a difference. Okay, we have another integral attack, and sixth round of this. Yeah, the idea is similar as the original square attack. We just have a four-round integral attack that will result in a balanced state here. We just get some specific key nipples to calculate backward from the ciphertext to check if this balance is set. Satisfied. At last, we introduce some time memory data trade-offs. Because for generic clock server, we have only a time memory trade-off. We only have a time memory trade-off using Hellman's table. But for this FS construction, we have a very interesting equation, is that let the AFP be the input and output value of the first call. Then we have a very interesting equation, is that this equation. On the right side of the equation, this value. The value of the right side can be calculated offline. We just choose a value of A and guess value of K, then we get value of B. So for some value of A and all the possible values of K1, we can store and calculate and store all these values into the lookup table. Then for the long plaintext and subtext pairs, we can calculate this, the left side, and look up into the table. Once we have a match, we have a suggested key. So with this algorithm, this trade-off has an equation like this. Data times memory goes in, where n is the size of the key space. And the pre-computation is only 2 to the 128 minus p. It's less than the Hermann's table trade-off. But here the time is always square root n. And the memory is always bigger than this one. So we want to introduce more trade-off to make this time, the time compressing tunable. So we will build another Hermann's table for principle. For the Hermann's trade-off, the equation is like this, tm squared plus n squared. And it's the tables are built for some given plaintext A. With this node, A will build the tables. And once we know the ciphertext, we can use this table to find the value of K1. Then, when we combine the Hermann's table one more time, it can work like this. We just choose a set of value A. And then, for each of the value A, we build the Hermann's table for principle. Then, when we have a plaintext subtext pair, we just choose one value of A, and then get the value of X, the key zero, just by calculating the actual sum of them. Then we will have the value of the post-whitening key. Then we have the value of B. Then we can use the Hermann's table to find the value of key 1. With this algorithm, and this trade-off equation becomes T, and this square equals n to the 2.5. And our trade-off, this trade-off is better than Hermann's trade-off when the data is more than n to the 1/4. And because here, we only build the table for principal, whose key size is only half of the principal. If we can store everything, if we have enough memory, we can just store everything in a single table. And then this trade-off comes even better. Okay, that's a summary of all our results. In our paper, we just provide a bunch of third-party analysis of the new block cipher prints. Hope our results will improve our understanding of this new block cipher. That's it. Thank you.
Is there any question for Swan?
Hi, thanks for your very nice work. I have more of a comment rather than a question. So your attack on single key prints full with 12 rounds seems to contradict not only our claim, but also our proof. So we have a generic proof that takes rise to this problem. And so what what seems to have happened is that actually we misinterpreted our own proof. And in fact, instead of claiming 2 to the n minus 1 security, we should have claimed 2 to the n minus 2. And I think then everything would be fine again.
Algorithm, you can evaluate the complexity with this attack. So, yeah, maybe this bound have, we have improved this bound a little bit.
Is there any more question? If no, let's thank Song again.